Yo, what's up, everybody? It's your boy CMB, the ambassador, and it's Hidden in Plain Sight, a book review, and we're about to get started in about 32 seconds. Let's go. What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Back to Bible Basics, or it's really more of our interview show, you know, Knights of the Round Table, as it were. I'm gonna have a special guest tonight, who's the author of the latest and greatest book from the UA apologetics community. Before we get into all that, though, I want to shout out to a couple people that's in the chat already. I see my sister from another Miss Dean New. God bless you. Glad that you could join us. And I see my brother Richly Redeemed as well, too. God bless you. Thank you for joining us, my good friend, as well, too. Met him in person earlier this year. And man, I'll tell you, he's a good brother as well. So thank God for you and what you do. And I see Jerry. What's good, man? Welcome. This is the Hulk and the Ultimate Warrior. That's what's good, man. Look, thank you for that. I appreciate it. I see Devin Payne in the building. What is good? Welcome to you, my friend. Please, as you come in, it doesn't cost you a dime to join in, but you got to hit the like button. That's your admission charge tonight. I see Brother Adrian Jones. Welcome, everybody, as they're coming in and filtering in. So for you, those of you that have been following the channel for a while, this is a brother of mine. Welcome all the way from Bacayad, you know, all the way from Jamaica. A stranger to very few people. He should not be a stranger to anybody. Before we get into the book, I want this brother to introduce himself. He goes by the name of Pastor Elsie Jr. Thunder Lauriston. Welcome, my brother. How are you today?
Blessing, CMB. Nice to be here with you, bro. Of course, you know, much respect. I appreciate you. You know, we do a lot of work together. I've been doing a lot too, especially since the past year. A lot of, you know, lot of underground work to put out there. So I'm grateful to be able to be back here, to be here with you to share on one of these major projects that was in the work. For those who don't know, you could just do a quick Google search and you learn all about me. I was an SDA evangelist. I left about 5 years ago. Now I'm a Christian minister, anti-SDA, anti-Sabbatarian apologist. I'm married, have two kids, and I'm just busy with the Lord's work, basically. Amen. Yeah, that's about it.
All right, man. Well, glad you could join us tonight, man. And listen, family, if you haven't heard, you've been hiding under a rock someplace, this is the author of this great work here. I'm trying to get it just right in my light. Here we go. It's called Hiding in Plain Sight, The False Doctrines of Seventh-day Adventism, Volume 1, by this author right here. I was blessed to have gotten an early copy of the manuscript, kind of take a look at it and do some feedback. And let me tell you, it was fire then. And I've been able to kind of binge through it already since the first one, the draft on September 1st. And my goodness, it's even more fire. Like, how can you do that? This is amazing, man. It's a good day. And I do apologize in advance for my voice. I've been under the weather. So if I start laughing, I might start, you know, hacking up a lung here. Just ignore me. Keep on talking. Yeah, but so much, man. Been so good to have you again and as a brother in ministry. If someone would be so kind to put that in the chat, the link, this is available on Amazon as we speak. But, you know, again, yeah, so Seventh-day Adventism, you left 5 years ago. I left actually about 18 years ago, believe it or not. I was not a pastor. I was a lay member. I left 18 years ago or so. A lot of the things that you bring out have been bringing out for the last several years, are some things that I knew and then some things I didn't know, you know, as well too. So this has been, an amazing second half of the journey, you know, so far and kind of seeing what God has done. And so we're just going to jump right into it, man. We're talking about the false doctrine of Seventh-day Adventism. And of course, if we're talking Seventh-day Adventism, for most of the people that know about the history of Seventh-day Adventism, they know about at least about Ellen White or have heard about Ellen White. All right. So in your book, you say a couple of good things that some people might find controversial, but are actually extremely true. Right? One of the things that you say is Ellen White is to Seventh-day Adventism what Muhammad is to Islam and Joseph Smith is to Mormonism. Can you tell us a little bit about her and what she actually means to SDAism and what you mean by that?
Yeah, sure. And of course, I don't just make wild claims. I don't just say things, you know, just beat in the air. I sufficiently prove what I say or conclude from their sources.
Absolutely.
Her personal statements, as well as with what the Adventist Church has bequeathed on her, said about her, hold her to be. So it's on that basis that I say that. Now, when you look at
Thunder, we lost you, brother. There you are, you're back. All right, we just lost you for a minute.
Yeah, I'm here. Okay. So when you look at the history of Adventism, Islam, and a number of the other cults and quasi Christian groups that now plague the body of Christ, there are common threads that run through all of them. And so Muhammad came up with Islam. He's the bedrock of Islam. He's the interpreter of Islam. He's responsible for the theology, the views, the practices, etc. Is the same thing for Adventism. Is the same thing for the Mormons and Joseph Smith. The same thing for the Jehovah's Witnesses and Charles Russell and Mary Eddy and Christian Scientists and Helena Blavatsky and the Theosophical Society, etc. Mm-hmm. And so these specific figures are the heart, they are the brain, they are the skeletal structure. I mean, so many important things and aspects of those specific faith systems. And so when you go into Adventism, Adventism embraces Ellen White as its end time, last day prophet.
Yeah.
When you go into the history as to how Adventism came about, developed theologically and structurally, socially, etc., it's all Ellen White.
Yeah.
Right? What Ellen White approved, propagated, explained, and held on to is what Adventism became. What she rejected is what Adventism rejects, mm-hmm. right? And yep. the list goes on. And so it's not an empty claim and conclusion. It's factual. And when persons read the book, take your time and go through chapter 2 very properly. Take as long as you need to. And when you finish, it's the only thing you can conclude, right? And as I say, it's not just me, you know, just blowing hot air. But from her writings, from the most authoritative among them, their 28 Fundamental Beliefs, conference presidents past and present, mm-hmm. I mean, you name it, the highest levels of authority among them. And so it's not just a claim, but it's a fact.
Yes, indeed. I want to welcome a couple other folks that just popped in recently. I see the BK Apologist. What's good, my brother? And Minister Williams, welcome, my friend. How are you doing? Glad that you could join us tonight. Yeah, bro. So let me ask you this, right? Because as a former Seventh-day Adventist, you know, at one point in time, before I even left the church, I tried to separate myself from Ellen White, you know, and I said, you know what, those guys, they're fanatics or whatever, they do what they do, but me, I'm a Jesus guy, you know what I'm saying? is there a way that, now here's what you said, let me back up. You said that Ellen White is to Adventism, Ellen White is Adventism, and Adventism is Ellen White. There's no way around it, okay? Now, I tried to separate myself from that. Okay, and I recognize that I couldn't. What would you say to people who think that are still on the inside in Seventh-day Adventism, who think that they can separate themselves and the doctrine from Sister White? What would you say to people like that?
They're only fooling themselves. I've spoken to a lot of individuals from the PhD levels to the layman, to the liberals, the progressives, the open theists among them, you name them. They're only fooling themselves. Mm-hmm. They ain't fooling nobody else. Because again, when you look at the structure, what they hold on to, even those who are merely cultural SDAs. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, why is Saturday anything special to you? Because of Ellen. Why are you focused on vegetarianism and veganism? Mm-hmm. Because of Ellen White. Why are you holding on to a last thread of hope in the Adventist Church? Mm-hmm. Because of Ellen White. And so there are so many things when you go into it. As I said, you know, not just the theological structure, mm-hmm. but even the organizational structure of the church, mm-hmm. the cultural structure, the social structure, any way you look at it, the heartbeat of it, the bedrock of it, the skeletal system of it is Ellen White. And so I don't know how you're going to meaningfully disassociate from her, yet you are in something that rests essentially solely on her. Like, I don't know how is that possible. It's like coming into my house, you know, I built it from the ground up, and then you can try remain in my house but disassociate me from my house.
Right.
And say, this has nothing to do with me. Like, I don't know what sort of personal deception or cognitive dissonance that you have to be involved in to successfully do that, but that's not possible. It just can't happen. That's like, you know, Muslims saying, well, we are Muslims and, you know, our lives are guided by the Quran and the Hadith and the other things. But, you know, Muhammad is nothing to us. Right, he doesn't influence us in any way. Like, it's just ludicrous.
I think that's probably one of the oddest things too, because like you really try, you could try, you know, you really could try, but it's you just can't. I mean, you hear it from the pulpit, you know. Sister White says, my favorite author says, you know, if you're going to do a Sabbath school, you know what I mean, at 9:15 every morning, you know, on Sabbath morning, if you're going to go there, the whole lesson, it culminates on Fridays. It's divided up into daily lessons, you know. And it culminates on Friday evenings that you should be kind of studying with quotes from Ellen White. So that's kind of what you kind of end up meditating on and walking into quote unquote Sabbath morning with that on your heart. You know what I'm saying? For the lessons and the other programs and so forth like that. It really cannot be separated. So that's one thing that I think people maybe on the outside looking in need to really understand, you know, as far as that goes. But yeah, this book, man, it's been fantastic. Again, we're talking about Hiding in Plain Sight right here. I hope you can see that on my screen pretty good here. But in this book, I'm not going to give away all the chapter titles, but I'm going to read a couple for you. Chapter two, it talks about Ellen White and her role in the doctrines and denominational life. So if you think what we're saying is not accurate, go check this and take your time with it. There are receipts for days in this book. Let me tell you. We talk about receipts longer than CVS. We are not playing, okay? So there's receipts for days. And you go over multiple types of things, multiple doctrines. You talk about the gospel. You talk about the investigative judgment. You talk about Michael the Archangel. Okay, the goats, all right, the scapegoats doctrines, all these kinds of things. Now, before we go into all this, I want to kind of touch on something real quick. And I noticed something, right? The biggest thing that you cover in this particular book, right? And mind you, this is volume one, y'all. So just get ready. Oh my goodness, right? So volume one, what you devote probably six, I could even argue seven chapters to the investigative judgment. Wow. So for those who do not know what that is, can you kind of give us a quick rundown as much as you can? You know, just give us a couple minutes worth of a rundown of what it is, right? And how important is the concept or the doctrine of the investigative judgment to Seventh-day Adventism? And I also want to ask you another question. Could Seventh-day Adventism survive without this doctrine?
Sure. So I spent so much time on it. Because it continues to be a sore point in Adventism. Mm-hmm. Individuals who begin to look into it, they really find this to be the most glaring, you know, mm-hmm. of its issues, even though there's a whole lot more. And so the approach I took, because there's so much that has been written on it, I have, you know, tons of materials on it, mm-hmm. is to simplify it for the body of Christ as to what are the glaring issues. You know, I didn't get into Daniel 8 and breaking it all down or refuting it, but just get into what is the big issue with it regarding the gospel. Yeah. And as I go into it, I focus on the main issues. It couldn't be dealt with in, you know, one or two chapters because there are so many anti-gospel heresies with it. And mm-hmm. so that's why I did that. Now, the investigative judgment of SPAs is basically their face-saving lie and cover-up mm-hmm. for the failed prophecy and failed expectation of Jesus' return in October 22, 1844. And so after they experienced that disappointment for the third time, the third one, that's why it's called the Great Disappointment, because there were two prior to it. Mm-hmm. From March 21, 1843 to March 21, 1844, they expected him to come.
Yeah.
Return. He didn't return those two times. And finally, they went back to the drawing board, did a lot of, you know, a bunch of gymnastics, theological gymnastics and proof texting, and came mm-hmm. with the seven-month movement, and then they penned October 22, you know, of the Jewish year as that day when he must return. Hmm. It was total chaos with respect to, you know, what occurred with them. And I document sure. a lot of that in the book as well. Yes, in chapter one. So after that, the following day, Hiram Edson and a few claimed that as they were walking through a cane field, that he saw the heavens opened and instead of Jesus returning to earth, he actually moved from the holy place of the heavenly sanctuary into the most holy place to begin a work of investigative judgment. And so when he would have relayed this to Ellen White and the SDA pioneers and she bought into it, then Ellen White just started having visions all over the place about this investigative judgment. Gave it a stamp of approval. It became Adventist doctrine. She even says, you know, it's the heart of their faith, mm. right? The foundation of the Advent movement. And she quotes Daniel 8:14, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. And then mm-hmm. she went to elaborate and explain what the investigative judgment was.
Okay.
Now, this doctrine basically has it that no one is currently saved right now. No one is currently truly, really saved.
Okay, so right? I see a couple people I don't see all the time. Say that again for the people. So nobody is currently saved right
nobody
now.
Nobody is currently really truly saved.
Okay, I want to make sure we didn't miss that.
Christ, when he went to the most holy place, mm-hmm. Began investigating the sins of all generations past until mm-hmm. he comes to the living and the last generation who would have took upon themselves the name of Jesus. And so beginning from Adam, to all his generation, those who are dead, he's going to, with microscopic scrutiny,
mm-hmm.
investigate their lives to see if they have any sin. And if there's just one sin, unrepentant sin, they're going to be lost and rejected. Right? Okay. It don't matter whether you're in Christ or not.
I'm going to have you pause right there because, like I said, I grew up in this from birth, right? And let me tell you, it is a legitimate fear. If you're preaching this doctrine correct, right? In the SDA church, if you're a kid listening to this, if you're an adult listening to this and you believe what's being said, you have no idea if that last one was your last one. Like, I'm dead serious. You have no idea. And the fear, the fact that people would get baptized multiple times for minor mistakes. I mean, like people would go out here and be on the altar like every week. Lord, I just want to be saved. Walking with the Lord for 25, 30 years, 40 years, and I want to be saved. Right? Uh-huh. Brother Devin Payne, I see a question. Hold off on the end for that question. That's a great question. Come back to that in a little bit later. So hang on to your questions, guys, until the end, because we don't want to miss anything. Okay. So go ahead, brother. I just want to let you know it's a legitimate fear factor, you know, with respect to salvation. But go ahead, bro.
Yeah, it is crippling. It is spiritual abuse, psychological abuse, career abuse, you name it. People have literally destroyed their lives, forfeited their lives and careers because of this doctrine. And so Christ is investigating the sins of everyone from Adam to all of his generation and every successive generation till he reached to us and the last one when he finished with the dead, moved to the living. And when I talk about microscopic scrutiny splitting hairs, I am not exaggerating.
That's great.
Everything is documented in the book with respect to this. And if there's just one sin, you're doomed, you're toast. And of course, this is dovetailed in with sinless perfectionism, you know, and all of that, veganism and all of the different, you know, Sabbath keeping and all of that. So the doctrine is grotesque. Yeah. It is a horrendous anti-biblical doctrine, anti-gospel doctrine. Jews would have been reading their scriptures in Hebrew for millennia. They never discovered this doctrine. The Christian church was around 1862 years before Adventism, never saw this doctrine. And even when they invented it, Christians came after and were still here and still cannot discover this doctrine legitimately from scripture. And so it is the only doctrine that is, well, the most pivotal, that is unique to Adventism, the investigative judgment doctrine. It's a heresy. Adventism can't stand without it. Adventist scholars like Dr. Angel Manuel Rodriguez have said it. Dale Ratzlaff, a former Adventist scholar and pastor too. Everybody who studies it, that's what they conclude. Yeah, there's four. Yeah. That's why it was such a big issue when they had to fire him and so many left pastors and others left in the 80s when he discovered the error of this doctrine and was trying to get the church to change direction with respect to it. So it's very horrible. And you know, so as you go through the chapters, you'll see how I show what they believe and also how it's against scripture and what scripture teaches regarding their beliefs to that effect.
That's one thing I can really appreciate with you. I'm going to read one more chapter heading, right? Where is it? You know, I just lost it right here. Anyway, I'll come back to it here. But you do juxtapose these doctrines specifically with the gospel, right? And that's one of the things that I can really appreciate with you. A lot of people that will say that they want to do apologetics or polemics specifically, you know, attacking certain doctrines, they just kind of come out there and just kind of and start swinging swords. Or what they'll do sometimes is build straw man arguments. And those are arguments that are kind of misrepresent the positions of the opponent, so to speak, and kind of knock them down because they're easy to do. You do the opposite. You do what's called a steel man, beyond which I've not seen for a lot of people that are dealing with Seventh-day Adventism. And, you know, there is going to be little and nothing to quibble about this. Okay, because a lot of people, you'll see them, you know, you've seen the Steven Andersons before and all these other people that have come out there and say, you know, SDA is this, that, and the third. And then they'll just point out one thing, they got that wrong. So you can't believe them, you can't listen to a word they say, right? You do the opposite. You go out of your way to get their documentation, their words from Ellen White and others, and kind of build up the doctrine, show you how they teach it, and then you bring it back down with the scriptures. So I definitely appreciate that. And for even for that much, that's what you need to do, because you want to make sure that you're getting a proper understanding, all that getting good understanding, so to speak, right? But yes, this is one of the things that I truly appreciate about what you said. And just to be clear, this is the linchpin doctrine. Okay, that makes Seventh-day Adventism tick. There's a whole something called the Great Controversy theme or Great Controversy worldview. We're not getting into that in this volume, which I'm sure it's coming in the next two volumes here as well too, that you're gonna be touching on. But my goodness, this thing is like it's the central spoke in the wheel. Now, with that said, a lot of people in the church would argue that the investigative judgment, their view of the Sabbath, and other key denominational distinctives are biblical, okay? And they have the proof text to prove it, right? Now here's the question. I want you to ask you, and we talked about this briefly on air before, off air rather. What's proof texting, and what is problematic about it?
Well, proof texting is basically ignoring and perhaps deliberately rejecting to all of the established and sensible rules of interpreting literature, such as asking who wrote this, why was it written, to whom it was written, what was the circumstances under which it was written, what was the language, what type of literature it is, how should it be interpreted, what was the message behind it, what did it mean to the audience, what can it mean today? You know, those kinds of stuff. That's called hermeneutics or inductive Bible study or reading literature. Proof texting rejects or ignores all of that. Proof texting, you have a preconceived notion, assumption, or idea, and you basically just hunt. You know, like Elmo Fudd, I'm hunting rabbit. And you just...
The Elmer Fudd ministry. Oh my goodness, Elmer Fudd school of theology. Oh man.
So you hunt for a proof text or something that seems to say what you already believe. Yes. And you use that now as proof or justification for what you already believe or conceive, whether it's passed on to you or you you developed it by whatever, you know, fanciful other means and ways. That's what proof texting is.
Gotcha.
That is the basically hermeneutical approach of Adventism, right? Proof texting is not a recommended, nor should be a practice of interpreting and understanding literature.
Right? Yeah, it definitely should not be a primary way to study the scriptures, right? Right. Now, what about people that would ask about, well, doesn't the Bible say line upon line, precept upon precept? What does that mean?
Oh, man, I stripped that down to the bone too in the book, in chapter 9. But that is not referring to Bible study. That is actually God referring to the prophets he was sending to correct Israel, you know, but they were obstinate and disobedient. And so he resorted to discipline them, line upon line, precept upon precept, hand little, there little. Mm-hmm. Now, that was referring to how they would actually, Jews, adults, and teachers would teach children the alphabet or the Hebrew characters. They would take their time to teach him how to draw them, line upon line, precept upon precept, a little here and a little there. And so the people were annoyed that Isaiah was doing this, kept on trying to talk to them and speak to them God's words like they were little children. So they rejected the message and all the prophets he was sending to do that. They rejected it. So God says, since you want to be arrogant like this and you would have, you know, been so obstinate, then I'm going to discipline you like little children. Line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. Isaiah 8:13. You notice SDS love to use verses 9 and 10, but they never, almost never, go to verse 13. It was a curse. It was God's judgment upon them. I'll discipline you this way so that you may fall backward, be ensnared, broken, and taken.
My goodness.
That's what that was. It's not a Bible study method.
No. Nothing to do with Bible study. And I think that's one of the things that we have to be careful, because you do point out that this is a proof text about proof texting. You know?
Yep.
So, and that's one of the things, family, that we, as you're listening to this and people that are be tuning in later on, listening, you know, hi, welcome, you know what I'm saying? Whether you're friends or not friends, whatever, it doesn't matter. We're glad that you're here. Here's the thing. You want to be careful with anybody that's just telling you the Bible says blank, right? And fill in the blank, because it could be something that's in the middle of a conversation, that's in the middle of a paragraph, that's in the middle of a book that is trying to articulate a whole argument or a whole line of thought. So you can't just take one verse, because remember, the Bible was never written The majority of the Bible wasn't written in verse and chapter form almost from the beginning, right? You have books like Proverbs that could be standalone verses you could probably use. You'd have books like Psalms that you could probably use as standalone verses, things of that nature, or songs, you know, or poems or what have you. You know, but more often than not, what you're looking at is some sort of narrative literature that would require sometimes several chapters to cover the whole event or conversation that's going on. So we definitely don't want to stop right in the middle, you know, and just pick that, some nonsense up like that. So that's really good. I think we want to make sure that we're absolutely clear on that, right? Since we have a couple more minutes here with you, I want to touch briefly on a couple of proof texts. Okay. Now, we see things like Matthew chapter 5. Okay. And we see this with Seventh-day Adventists. We see this with our Hebrew Israelite friends, some of them, not all of them. They're not a monolith. We want to be aware of that. Right. But we see that with a lot of folks like this that like to promote law keeping and things of that nature. Right. I'm going to read it to you guys in the chat here. It says Matthew 5 and verse 17. This is Jesus talking. He says, "Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I did not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter, no one stroke of a letter will pass away from the law until all things are accomplished or until all is fulfilled." How would you address a proof text like Matthew chapter 5 here? What would you say to people like that, that would kind of shake that in your face and be like, aha, you're not really preaching the truth here?
Yeah, sure. I thoroughly deal with that in the book as well. I also did presentation is on YouTube on that passage as well, so persons can check it out for, you know, the thorough breakdown. But you just simply stop them and take them one verse at a time in context. Mm-hmm. Look at it as to what it says. They use it to promote legalism, whereas Jesus is saying that he actually came to fulfill the law and the prophets, which is the entirety of Old Testament scripture. And when he fulfills them, their use would have been served. They will not be operative any longer. That's what he is saying. And the statement, until heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle in no wise pass from the law, until all is fulfilled, is not saying that heaven and earth still stands, therefore we are still under that law. He's actually affirming, given the certainty that he knows he's going to fulfill the law and the prophets. And before he does, nothing of it will be passed. So he's going to complete it all. Mm-hmm. That's what he's saying there. And when he has fulfilled it, he ushers in something better, something different. Right? And so when you contextually look at it and you break down the various Greek terms and construction, you'll see that clearly. Even just basic English reading of it, just understanding literature, and apply an exegetical approach to understanding literature, you'll see clearly that that's what he's saying and the figure of speech he's using there. And so with that and all of the other prominent proof texts they use, that's the approach you should take. Read it in context. And if you need background information, historical data, all of that is helpful too. And deciphering with what scripture is actually saying.
Amen. 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 Good. I want to touch on one more. Talked about that briefly in passing as well too. Isaiah chapter 66. This is one that you see all the time. And Isaiah 66, the Lord's talking. He says, "All humanity will come to worship me from one new moon to another and from one Sabbath to another," says the Lord. And this is Isaiah chapter 66, verse 23. What I notice is that anytime we have talks with particular SDAs that talk about the new heavens and the new earth, right? They want to come and say that we'll be keeping the Sabbath in heaven. And this is one of the, if not the only one, the main one that they use to try and buttress this this idea. Talk to us a little bit about that one here. Like I said, we're not going to have you do the full exegesis, but just kind of, you know, give us a kind of quick rundown of why that's not really the case here for us.
Sure. Interestingly enough, just before I came on the program, I'm actually working on the chapter on that now in volume 2.
Oh, we're getting a sneak peek.
I quoted what
You heard it here first.
And what, you know, the latest scholarship in trying to push that position, Dr. Skip McCarty, in this book here. I have it right here because I'm actually sourcing them.
There you go.
Perspectives on the Sabbath, the Four View, where he argued that this means we'll keep the Sabbath in heaven, therefore it must be kept now. But again, contextually, the text is not talking about that, right?
No.
I had dealt with that in the book I wrote on the Sabbath, which you need to know. That's on Amazon as well. Mm-hmm. But they can cop that, and I'm dealing with it in Volume 2 as well. I dealt with some aspects in Volume 1 too, and the faulty hermeneutical principles, Chapter 9 of Volume 1. So you'll see some aspects of Isaiah as well, 66, 22 to 23. But when you look at that text, 65 and 66, it's one contextual unit that the prophet is describing the return of the exiles from Babylonian Medo-Persia captivity. And he's contrasting where they are with their Jerusalem, where God is going to bring them back. And when you go into Old Testament theology and apocalyptic language that relates to deconstruction or destruction of the earth is always referring to God bringing judgment on a nation or somebody. There's always, the earth is becoming formless and void again. Yeah. Cities are broken up and it's turned into a desert and the kind of thing. He's bringing judgment. When it uses creation or recreation language, it speaks to restoration, right? And it's all over the Old Testament. And so when Isaiah talks about that, you know, he's talking about when God restores Israel back to Jerusalem out of captivity, their home Jerusalem is going to be as or like, it's a simile, it's a comparison, as or like the new heavens and the new earth. And then he describes certain conditions that they are going to experience. Whereas they were experiencing a lot of death and oppression and insecurity in Babylon and before because of their disobedience, there's going to be proper worship. They are going to be the Levites, the missionaries going around on camels, you know, to bring people and Gentiles to worship God. And then it says from one new moon to another, or month, however you want to translate it, makes no material difference. And from one Sabbath to another, all flesh will come to worship before him. Now, when you look at the condition before the captivity and even in captivity, and Isaiah 65 and 66 describes that, right? They were worshiping God syncretistically, sporadically, and thinking they are holier than others, right? They are in the gardens eating swine flesh, broth of the mouse, and all of that kind of stuff. And they are saying, stand by yourself because I'm holier. So God says when he restores them, their worship in him is going to be from new moon to new moon, or from one new moon to another. And that specific Hebraic phrase or expression literally means continuously, all the time, throughout, right? From two, it includes everything in between.
Yes.
Right? And that's throughout the Old Testament too. I can prove that. Like two quick examples. When he was describing in Isaiah chapter 1, the total depravity of the nation before the captivity, in verses 5 to 6, he says, from the crown of the head to the sole of the foot, there's no soundness in it, only wounds, bruises, and putrefying sores, right? From the crown to the foot, everything in between, you're completely messed up, right? Total depravity.
Yeah.
When Job had boils, from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet, in the Psalms, the name of the Lord is to be praised from the rising of the sun to the setting down of the same.
That's right.
Continuously, all day, every day.
Yes.
Right? So that's what that Hebraic expression meant. All the time, totality, completely. And so when it says from one new moon to another, it means every time in between. The new moon marked the month. So at the beginning of the month and every time in between that, you will worship me. One Sabbath to another, the Sabbath marked the weekly cycle. One Sabbath to another, and every time in between, you will worship me faithfully. So it means when you are restored, you're going to worship me as you should, as the law had prescribed, all day, every day, faithfully. That's what that is talking about. It's not talking about the new heavens and earth of Revelation, you know, and that kind of stuff on Sabbath keeping, because more problems arise for them than it solves, because you're going to have to deal with what the passage says, such about sin and death and thieves and poisonous snakes and, you know, riding on camels, corpses, you know, on the,
you know, outside the city, corpses, the next verse.
Pig, you know, the pig. And the, I mean, there are so much problems. Mm-hmm. Then when you get into Revelation, you know, the absence of the moon to give light, and there's no night there, and the Sabbath and the new moon was regulated by the sun and moon, according to Genesis 1 verses 13 to 14 and other places. Then, you know, it creates more promise for them. Not only that, but the various conditions that are different in the two scenarios. So it's not talking about that at all. And so we shouldn't be much bothered by it. Again, proper contextual reading and exegesis will actually show that.
That's right. That's right. As you know,
oh, just before we move on,
sure. Yeah.
Let me give you a teaser.
Ooh, triple B exclusive. Hold on, go ahead. Go ahead, brother.
Proof text that horrible.
Yes.
Ellen White proof text those two verses to advocate for mandatory and eternal Sabbath keeping in heaven.
Okay.
She quotes it exactly as it is in Isaiah. Three times she does it.
Okay.
From one new moon to another, from one Sabbath to another, we all will gather, we all will assemble to worship God. Here's the problem for Adventists. She proof texted to enforce the Sabbath, but in that proof text itself contains the new moon aspect. So if this means that the Sabbath has to be kept now because it'll be kept in heaven, by virtue of that text, and the construction is the same, there's no way around it.
Yeah.
Both of them are from two, right? Two time periods being expressed here.
All right.
Then why aren't they keeping the new moon festivals now?
Well,
and it also shows via her proof text and her being their authoritative prophet that they will be keeping the new moons in heaven too.
Mm-hmm.
So why aren't they keeping that now? Yeah, with no moon, right?
Wow.
Man, I'm having a lot of fun with the madness in volume two. Yes, I can tell you that.
Fantastic, man. This is great, man. I'm having a good time already tonight, guys. Put a one in the chat if you're doing great and enjoying yourself as well, too. I appreciate you so far, man. I got only one or two more questions to ask. In the meantime, while we're getting on the last couple questions with Thunder, I would like for all of you, if anyone has questions, you got a couple minutes for Q&A, right, brother?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, sure. Good stuff. And if you wouldn't mind, put question in front of your question and ask your question here. So we're going to get prepared for Q&A. We're going to spend a great deal of time with it, but we'll do a couple of bits for Q&A here. And we got a Triple B exclusive that's Back to Bible Basics with the Ambassador. So glad that you can join us for that. Now, this last one, I know we've been kind of keeping it a little bit light for this one. I didn't want to give away a lot of the stuff that's in the book. I want people to go ahead and get the book. Sweet Ones MCs, she said that she got the physical copy and the digital copy. I did too. I could not wait because it was supposed to come on the first, and it didn't come on the first, so I went and bought the Kindle copy. It came on the second, but I'm glad I got both. So, you know, I'm glad for it as well too. Praise God for that. Happy to support any way I can. But here's the thing, right? And when you have denominations or groups, or what have you, any organizations like that that have these last day claims, exclusive claims, right? The SCA Church has a doctrine that they're the true remnant church of Bible prophecy, etc. And when you have these claims and people like you, people like me, people like others who kind of come against them and kind of poke them in the eye and tell them, point them back to the scriptures, like, yo, this is not right and exact, right? We get a lot of pushback from that. And there's not just regular pushback or we don't like you. It is you're evil and you're a Jesuit and you're the agent of Satan and so forth. This is the kind of pushback that we get from a lot of folks in that, not everybody, mind you, but a lot of folks in that denomination. And also, Ellen White says something specific, and I want to kind of read it for those who don't know and then ask you a question about it. In Selected Messages, Volume 1, page 48, Ellen White says this: The very last deception of Satan will be to make of none effect the testimony of the Spirit of God. Satan will work to unsettle the confidence of God's remnant people in the true testimony, end quote. And for those who don't know, right, whenever SDAs are referring to the testimonies, primarily, about 9 times out of 10, they're talking about Sister White's writings, okay? And so, again, the last sentence was, Satan will work to unsettle the confidence of God's remnant people, that's them, in the true testimony, that's her. So, Thunder, I have to ask you, are you here to unsettle the confidence of God's remnant people in the true testimony? And if not, what are you doing? Why are we engaging in apologetics? And why are you defending the Christian faith?
Let me tear into that quote a little bit.
Please do.
Firstly, this quote shows the spiritual megalomaniacal conceptualization Ellen White had about herself on biblical matters. Right? Notice the very last deception or issue will not be surrounding Christ and the gospel and scripture. It's her writings. Right? Did anybody caught that? The very last deception is going to be concerning her writings. What is that saying? It's saying quite a lot as to how she conceptualized herself and her writings and their importance. Right? And then she talk about Satan is going to do everything to unsettle the confidence of God's people in her writings. Well, obviously you have an issue with authority right there. Why couldn't it be scripture? Why is her writing so important that the very last is not one of, but the very last?
The last.
That's putting her above scripture. That's putting herself above scripture. So it's hugely problematic when you look at it, and it proves what I'm saying, that I'm not making these things up with respect to what she believed and conceptualized about herself and what the church affirms for her. Then we go into this, well, isn't that what I'm doing? Isn't she right because I'm doing this and Colin is doing this? Brothers and sisters, hear me out carefully. You see, a lot of these con artists and these prophets, they knew eventually people are going to come around, come along, investigate their statements and their lives and their stuff, and will discover that they were absolute scams. So to cover their backs and their bases and to try to still legitimize their prophetic authority, they make statements like these. They all do it, right? Check them all out. They all do it.
Yeah.
This is circular reason at best. And it's also just covering every base. Ellen White was a master of covering every base. No matter what move you make, what you do, that base is covered to try to justify or legitimize her prophetic status. But it's absolute nonsense. What I am doing, what Colin is doing, is no different from what scripture encourages us to do. And that is to defend the faith, expose darkness, reject false prophets, investigate their writings and reject them if they go against scripture. That's all that we are doing. Mary Baker Eddy has something similar to say about this. Joseph Smith and the Mormons, are they all the true prophet and therefore they're all right because they say this? What about Muhammad and all of the others and all of these prophets around today? Are they legitimate prophets of God and shouldn't be investigated before they said this? Absolutely not. All we're doing is applying them, investigating them to the text of scripture, their lives, their statements, their inconsistencies, their hypocrisies, etc. And if they don't line up with scripture, we reject them. That's all we are doing. But this is one of the, we call it now, the fear-mongering psychological tactics Ellen White actually used to keep Adventists boxed in and to keep demonizing those who perhaps God sent to help them so that they are stuck in their error. They are stuck in legalism and to never experience freedom in Jesus Christ. And so that's all I'm doing. It's the same way that all of the other prophets who are proven to be false are investigated and rejected. Same thing with Ellen White. No difference. And at the end of the day, I'm encouraging you to place your faith in Jesus alone and to stand on scripture alone, contextually exegeted. That's what I'm doing. And in her estimation, if that is going to take you to hell, then you should gleefully bust hell wide open. If that's what's going to cause me to end up in hell, I'm going to bust hell wide open. That's what you have to conclude at the end of the day.
Amen. Amen.
Now, with respect to why do the apologetics, well, scripture enjoins it upon us. Jude 3 says we are to contend for the faith that was once and for all delivered to the saints. Now, I'm a former SDA. This is what I'm extremely familiar and intimate with. It's against the gospel. It's against historic Christianity. It is against the freedom that Christians should experience in Jesus. Therefore, I present the facts concerning them and seek to expose people to the true gospel. This is why I do this aspect. Yeah. And by God's grace, whatever the results will be, that's up to him. But this is why I do so. Scripture enjoins us, and therefore we must. There are a lot of wolves among the body of Christ, a lot of false prophets. Therefore, we have to tackle them with the truths of scripture, with sound scripture rebuttals and exegesis, exposing their errors and egregious heterodox or heretical doctrines, and encourage people to stand on scripture alone, contextually expounded on.
Amen, bro. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I see a couple of questions coming in already. So we're going to go ahead and try and get the earlier ones here. I know there's a couple earlier. Someone had asked about the audiobook. I think that's being worked on, brother. Is that correct? That's what we're trying to do, aren't we?
That is in the pipeline. Nothing has started yet, but there are a few persons who have brought that to the fore, and so it's just for us to sit down and figure out how we're going to do it and to make it happen. I personally don't have the equipment to make that happen, and I don't think my voice is that captivating to do it myself either.
So the Bahamian Jamaican Haitian thing.
Yes, sir. So we gotta get some, some person who will have the time and the equipment to be able to do so. And then finances is another issue as well. Yeah. These things cost money, and I don't have any money. Right?
Right.
It's KDP I had to use to publish the book, because I couldn't do it with a big publisher or, out of pocket. So all of those factors have to be considered. And so if eventually we're able to have an audio or have audios for them, that would be very awesome.
Amen. So that'd be a great option for prayer, guys. If prayer or or other resources, certainly financial resources can help. But if you know anybody that does audiobooks or what have you, man, just let little brother Elsie know, and we'll get the contact information out there as well. And we'll try to do everything that we can within our power to get it done sooner rather than later. We know that audiobooks are the wave of the future for a lot of us that have long commutes or like to listen to things like this on as we're working out or cleaning around the house and try to get things done. So by all means, feel free. Devin Payne asked a question. How do they see Romans 10 and verse 13, which says, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved? How does the SDS typically look at that?
Yeah, so a text like that would have a lot of asterisks and be filtered through the investigative judgment. And so call on the name of the Lord would, have an asterisk. Then to the bottom, it would be explained to profess faith in Christ and keep his commandments. And saved would have the asterisk. Then the footnote or whatever would be if you pass the investigative judgment and that kind of thing. And so all of these, texts and passages that are clear as to what salvation is, when we receive it, how, they're all filtered through the lens of Ellen White's writings and the Adventist theology. As a matter of fact, Ellen White has a big quote on that, that if anyone comes with a heap and mass of scriptures if the interpretation of them, and that's in the book,
that's in the book.
if any scripture and a heap of scripture and you pile up, if the interpretation and application of any scripture goes against the doctrines of the Adventist church, mm-hmm. it ought to be rejected.
Yeah. And that's a scary thought, because the mass of scriptures won't convince you. I don't know.
What's going to do it?
That's a real deal. All right, Jerry. Jerry's got a question here. Are there any, I'm sorry, before Jerry asks a question, Richly Redeemed, on page 122, you talk about the positive and negative connotation of the law and the commandments. Can you touch on that?
Yeah, just briefly. The law has negative connotations, such as, you know, thou shalt not, and if you do, then you're gonna die. It's a ministry of death. It's merciless. Mm. Hebrews, I think, is either two or three talks about anyone who sinned under Moses' law, they died without mercy under the testimony of two or three witnesses. So that's the negative connotation of the law. Yeah. But the positive connotation or aspect of the law is that, you know, thou should not kill, meaning you should respect my life. You should respect the life of your brother, his sister, and preserve it. So it has both aspects to it. And when you go more into it too, with respect to the purpose and functions of the law, to point to Christ, to expose human sin and unrighteousness, God's unreachable, lofty, righteous, holy standard, and crushing us under the weight of sin, so that we may be inspired to go to Christ, who's the only option, then all of those are good things and connotations about the law as well. And so that's essentially what I mean.
Mm-hmm. All right, good stuff. Thank you, sir. See, Adrian Jones asked, what are the proof texts for the investigative judgment? We can just kind of touch on one or two, and I'll kind of chime in on that too, brother.
Yeah, sure. There's a variety of them. I dealt with a couple in the book as well. Genesis chapter 18, for example, with Sodom and Gomorrah, when God says he come down and he's going to see if the cry of it is as he has heard. They use that as a proof text. God came to investigate before he judge and execute judgment. First Peter chapter 4, that talks about the time has come for judgment to begin in the house of God, and if it begins with us first, what will the end of the ungodly and sinner be, and all stuff like that. They use that as well. Statements in the New Testament, when it talks about we must stand before the judgment seat of Christ, they use that a lot. Daniel 7, Daniel 8, coupled with aspects of Revelation, they use that a lot as well. With Jesus moving from being brought to the Ancient of Days, thrones were set down, etc. So they have a number of them that they actually use to try to justify the investigative judgment. But like I said, I didn't spend time on a lot of the things that I, you know, were peripheries. I referenced some resources that persons who want to just get intricate in it can do. I just focus on how this is the more egregious and glaring heresies about it in light of the gospel. And so I didn't you know, end up missing the forest for the trees, right? I focused on the forest.
Good deal. Also, Adrian Jones, I did put a comment in the chat here. I did a show recently with the BK Apologist on his channel, so shout out to BK. What's up, bro? Did a show with him talking about, like I said, top five probably SDA doctrines, and we did talk about this fundamental doctrines anyway, and we talked about this in some detail, so it kind of goes into some of the proof texting, how they got it, and then and so forth like that too. So there's feel free to check that out. There are the link is in the chat. All right, couple more questions, and we're winding down here, brother. Thank you again so much. For those that just tuned in, you're late, but welcome anyway. out here enjoying time with our dear brother, Elsie Thunder Lauriston, and talking about his book, Hiding in Plain Sight, The False Doctrines of Seventh-day Adventists. Now, a couple questions here. Jerry asks, are there any other books out there that go this deep against the SDA? I haven't seen any. So, this is... this is a great question. There's many actually out there, right? Tell us what.
Yeah, There are a variety of them, but I suppose because a lot of the authors are generally Caucasian, so they're not as popular among Black Christians. Dale Ratzlaff has Cultic Doctrines. Desmond Ford did a lot of work in The Investigative Judgment. Dr. Russell Earl Kelly. There are a couple others. Dr. Brian S. Newman, the former Adventist podcast. They do a lot of that too.
Yeah.
But the thing is, with a lot of them, the approach they took, I took a different approach, right? Because, of course, there's urban apologetics, more for the urban context. And, of course, simplifying things in such a way that everyone gets it without just bogging them down with all of these, scholarly jargon and things that they wouldn't find otherwise meaningful in their everyday context. So I sought to kind of be, very different. But with a lot of them, though, they have not gone as deep. I could tell you that. Right? A lot of the doctrines that I get into, like Ellen White and her authority, sometimes they'll just have one or two quotes and that's it, but they don't go deep and expansively show the implications. Issues with respect to Michael the Archangel and how the implications for Jesus' deity, I've not seen any that went as deep and as hard, as thorough with it. Issues with foods, very deep, with it. And a number of other things. The hermeneutical principles, I've not seen any to date who actually give a basic overview, a premise to these are the faulty assumptions and hermeneutical principles SDAs work off, right? Look out for them. This is how to spot them, and this is also how to refute them. The proof text they use, the more popular ones, and how to refute them, I've not seen them do a lot of that as well. The scapegoat doctrine, I've not seen them go real deep in it either. And so there are quite a number of books out there, great works, no doubt. I reference a whole lot of them. In the books, volumes, a whole lot of them. But in terms of the approach I took it from, the style and the feel and the effect that it's intended to have on the readers, I've not seen the others take that approach.
Yeah. And I'll say this much, man. Just having spent a lot of time with you in ministry over the last year plus, and it's been, man, it's been great just kind of reading this book. And it's, again, it's my third read through. Second full read through through the book here, man. It is like what we just did today. This kind of approach that is very accessible. It is scholarly. There are, again, plenty of receipts in this book. Trust me when I tell you, there are plenty of receipts in the book, but it's accessible. So anybody can read it, from the layman to the theologian. And the study that's available and the context that you throw in there for this small of a cost, bro, you are teaching seminary class in a couple chapters. Like, it's crazy, right? So I really appreciate that so much from you, man. I mean, my goodness, thank you so much for your time. We've been on for about an hour, and I don't see any additional questions in the chat. If I missed one, throw it on here real quick. If I missed your question earlier, I try to get to everybody if I could. But as we're wrapping up, brother, I just want to thank you, for this time that you're spending with us. And I know we've talked about it before.
And go ahead, just a quick point on that. And that to show too that the goal is not about you're just trying to get wealthy, off people's back with the book, right? Basically, what it's cost is a love offering, right? Because as you say, when you go through it, it's a whole year I've been working on these, right? Very small, because when I compare, other works similar, like, the price is much higher, but it's in consideration of the small man, the lay person who can't afford it if it's so high. So it's just something, below par that anybody could just a week or two save up or whatever, somebody can gift you with. Because the main thing is to get the information in your hands, right? And there are several persons who, because of their context, they don't have credit cards or they live in remote islands, you know, their context can't afford them to order it off Amazon, or the delivery will charge them 3-4 times more than the book. Yeah. And they've reached out to me and I send them free PDF copies, you know. So it's not about trying to make money. It's about getting the information out there for God's people, you know, to be blessed by the work, you know. And even persons, even from the States, their context, you know, they really want it. They are ogling for it, but it don't afford them to be able to get it. And so I just message them privately. You know, hey, shoot me up your email address. I'll send you a free PDF copy. And they greatly appreciate it. You know, so it's not about that, you know. It's just a small love offering for it to have this rich resource and information in your hands. And this is only volume one. Two more.
Volume one of three, right? So This is going to be amazing. Like I'm just glad to have some small part in it with you to celebrate with you, and also to kind of promote it as much as I can, you know.
Yes, sir. Like,
this is I really and truly wish, I'm not even, is no cap right here, this something that I really and truly wish I had coming out of Seventh-day Adventism. Again, I came out about almost 18 years ago, right? This was something that when you come out of a group organization like this, you honestly feel like you are by yourself. You, and I'm telling you, because all you've ever been taught, all I ever was taught from birth was, this is God's true church. And you know, you get the naysayers that come out right afterwards. And then the worst part is the internal dialogue that nobody else gets to hear except you. You know, that is scary. Am I doing the right thing? Is this really what God wants me to do? Am I being deceived?
Yep. What does scripture say now? What do I believe? Where do I stand?
Right.
How do I see these proof texts now? Yeah. What is the proper meaning of them?
Yeah.
I wrote it with all of that in mind.
Yes.
I write these volumes with that specifically in mind, that those who are questioning and coming out, it's like almost, as you can see, almost everything, the big glaring issues and questions they can have, and doctrines and proof text, etc., are dealt with. It's like everything in one kind of, you know, resource where they don't have to do what me and you had to do, fishing all over, pulling all kinds of literature together from all over the place, right? You just have something, you just take your time and go through, and it's going to sort out everything for you. I say, you know, when I die, they're still going to be here. I want them to be here to bless somebody. You know, that's the aim, that they can pick it up and it can bless them. And the responses and endorsements and, you know, expressions I've been getting so far from people, it has been really good. Some people who are transitioning, who are questioning right now, and, you know, it's been, you know, rocky in a lot of way in terms of, you know, Adventism destroys you as a person and your finances, or family, everything. When you begin to question to come out. So a lot of them are in that stage right now, but it's been a great help so far, you know, in their faith crisis and journey. And so I thank God for that.
Amen. Oh, I appreciate you so much. Thank you for your time, bro. Where can the people get a hold of you, man? How can the people get in touch with you, man?
They could find me on YouTube, EJ Thunder Lauriston. They could always subscribe to my channel. When I do, you know, post stuff, they could get them. Facebook, EJ Thunder Lauriston, Instagram, Teach Thunder. I joined TikTok recently, but I've not been, you know, done anything yet. Don't get the hang of it yet. They could find me there. They hit me up on Messenger. I'm an old guy, man. You know, we are old dudes. We need that for the young people. Messenger, you know, my phone number, those things are in the book as well, information. So, you know, feel free to get in touch with me. I'm not a offstandish, you know, kind of person. What you see is what you get, what you hear is what you get. So don't you know, feel intimidated to approach me. I occasionally post on Facebook, you know, so I'm around. People can find me and connect with me if they want to.
Good stuff, good stuff. And Sweet One says this, so thankful for you both, and the wealth of knowledge from each of you is invaluable. God bless you, my dear sister.
God bless you. That's just the Madeline. She's a former SDA as well. God bless you.
And you know, I got to meet her and her husband actually last year
before the pandemic. Yeah.
So great sister.
Yes, yes.
So wonderful family. Just having a good time, you know. Just fellowshipping at church, and then we went out to eat afterwards and just kind of hung out for a little bit and just talked for hours, man. It was a good time in the Lord. So good people right there for sure. And Jerry says, and he teaches Bible study on Wednesday.
I knew that as well.
All right, good stuff, man. All right, yeah. So I'm here. This is CMB. We got Elsa Jr. Thunder Lauriston. And when I say Thunder, you gotta catch this man on his YouTube when he's preaching. We're not playing, it's Thunder for real. So God bless you, my dear brother. Any final words for us tonight, man?
Y'all stay on scripture, stay focused on God. Yeah. And especially in these crazy days, whatever it is that's going to help build and nurture your faith, get a hold of it, take time with it, be careful given the context, the epidemic aid now. So be careful of that, of course. And of course, be on the lookout for these cults that are all over the place that are trying to rob you of your faith in Christ and your sweet Christian experience.
Amen. So with that said, man, I thank you all so much. As always, we love you with the love of Christ, even if we disagree with you. This is EJ, Pastor EJ Thunder Lauriston, and CMB the Ambassador, and we're out. We'll catch you on the next time, y'all. Peace.